Hi, I'm Jennifer Stein. Welcome to Main Line MUFON, the Mutual UFOs Network here at Radner Studio 21, the Main Line area's public access network. I have a very special guest with me today. His name is Joe Foster, and I'd like to give you a little background on his experience and why he's here presenting for us at Main Line MUFON. Joe Foster grew up in East Hampton, Long Island, New York, and in Central New Jersey. He enlisted in the U.S. Coast Guard in 1969 and served through 1973. While on active duty with the Coast Guard, he served as a navigational signalman, or quartermaster, on an Ocean Station Victor patrol and participated in what's known as Operation Market Time in Vietnam. Joe Foster is a retired information technology, electronics, and communication project manager. As an assistant vice president for data management at Merrill Lynch, Joe led technical support teams as a contractor for the Department of Defense, the Justice Department, and the FBI. This work focused around technology needs for automated weapon sites and advanced energy systems. Joe will present on his experiences at sea, discussing four major events which got his attention. These are four events out of 11 over his total lifetime. Joe feels that these experiences are profoundly significant. His personal journey to understanding these events inspired his research and presentation, which he created specially tonight for MUFON. He's also written about these experiences in the Mutual UFO Journal, which is published monthly. In his own words, he says, "Our lives truly are connected through a silver thread that, if recognized, provides each of us an incredible, valuable insight into our own lives and the world around us. Some of these experiences are awe-inspiring. For some, they're extremely frightening. And it's really up to each of us to choose what that experience is for ourselves." So I'm going to welcome Joe Foster. As I understand it, from the very beginning, you've had generational experiences in your family, and your experiences started at a very young age. So let's just stick to your stories. Can you tell us about some of your earliest known experiences, possibly with unusual phenomenon or UFO phenomenon when you were quite young?
My first experience was, I'm going to call it a crib experience for lack of better description. It happened one night. I found myself standing up in my crib, and I was staring catty-corner toward the baseboard or the footboard, and there at the end of the crib on the railing was, I always described it as a very, very scary clown. It had big black eyes, but I wasn't afraid. I remember just staring at it, and the image lasted maybe 10 seconds tops. I don't remember standing up when I saw it. I remember being wide awake, but I was only wide awake for about 10 seconds. Then I don't remember anything else. Years later, I went to my mother and father when my father was still alive, and I described the room. I described where the crib was in relationship to their bed. It was located at the foot of the bed on my mother's side, and closest to the bed was the footboard, and my headboard was furthest away. And they corroborated that, and I drew a picture of it years later, just to make sure that I understood exactly what I was seeing. I don't know what it means. I don't know if it was something other than just maybe a waking nightmare, but I was not afraid. And the thing was staring back at me, and it just had no expression. It was just a kind of a scary looking image.
Mm-hmm. So these experiences continued as you got into the military. And while you were out at sea, you served for quite some time, about, you said, 30 months at sea, or 10 months at sea?
20 months.
20 months at sea. Mm-hmm. So you were mostly in the Pacific?
It was a summer patrol, July. And we got out to Ocean Station, which is halfway between Hawaii and Japan.
It's
a little bit, couple hundred miles, about 1,000 miles, I guess, west of Midway Island. And our whole function there was, we were a navigation aid for ships and aircraft that were crossing the ocean. We also had a doctor on board, so if there was a medical emergency at sea, we were able to render assistance. We had a fully equipped operating room. We had also, we took bathymetric readings, which is temperature and salinity, and that was for the Navy.
And you watched the in the weather as well for the
Yes, and we also sent up balloons and radio sons in order to again gather weather information, passing it back to NOAA. So we had multifunction, but we sat on a 10 square mile grid, and during that time we spent keying our location, waiting for something to happen, which hopefully nothing would happen. And it was during that patrol one night, and I was this able-bodied seaman. I was just an SA at the time. We all had to stand watch, sea watch, and I had to go up to the bridge along with three of my shipmates, and we were actually going through our turnover, relieving the shift that was on. And at that time, there was the squawk box, which is a ship's intercom system. The radar operator down in combat information squawked us up on the bridge and said that they were tracking objects. They call them bogies. I guess that's a radar term anyway. And that the objects were actually coming out of the northeast, heading on a southwesterly direction. And they were going to cross over the ship. According to the radar operator, they're going to just pass directly over us. Then he cryptically said that they were clocking them at a speed that may not have been correct. He said that the speed was 3,500 miles an hour, and these were three objects flying together, and this was 1969. And I don't know of too many manned aircraft that would fly at that speed, that distance. So it was extraordinary.
And in that formation.
In a formation. It was in a triangular formation. Well, anyway, there were 13 of us on the bridge. My captain, who was the senior captain in the Coast Guard, he was an 06, and he was a master mariner. He could sail any ship at any time, any place in the world. He was on the bridge. The officer of the deck was on the bridge with his replacement. The quartermaster of the watch was on the bridge with his replacement. And then there were the four of us and our, you know, the people that we were replacing.
So they were more than normal because it was a switchover time.
It was
13 of you all total?
13, mm-hmm. Yep. And what we did when we got the bearing and range to the target, the ship's orientation was pointing to the north, so we would have all ran out to the right bridge wing or the starboard bridge wing and tried to get a view of where these objects were coming from. So we all did that, and sure enough, we picked up three very bright points of light on the horizon. And sure enough, just like the radar operator said, they flew directly over the ship, and we had to run through the bridge out to the port bridge wing because that's where they were disappearing in the southwesterly direction. Now, let me explain. The bridge wing itself is 44 feet above sea level.
Okay.
Now, if you're doing spherical trig, you would actually extend your horizon by the elevation.
The height of the ship, of course.
And of course, the objects were flying not at sea level, they were at an altitude too. I'm still not exactly sure what that altitude was. Nobody ever told me. And they would have extended the horizon even further. So from horizon to horizon, one of the officer of the deck actually timed this sighting, and it took about 7 seconds to go from horizon to horizon. So when they did some spherical trig, they broke out their slide rule. Again, we didn't have calculators back in those days.
So it's at least 50 miles in each direction, I'm guessing.
It was
100, closer to 100 miles?
No, I don't know because they never said that. They said that they were able to corroborate the speed, however.
Right.
And they had it at 3,200 miles per hour.
3,200 miles an hour.
Right. Now, that's only part of what happens in the sea services. Coast Guard is the sea service, as is the Navy. There was a instruction that was put out back in the 1950s, and it said anything of a national security interest would have to be documented and reported.
Now, does that fall under what we often refer to as JANEPS 146 ECHO?
Yes.
Okay, so just for the viewing audience, explain what that is, because I think that leads into right what you're going to talk about it.
Right.
It refers to what JANEPS is an acronym standing for?
Joint Army Navy... I'm not sure what the AP stands for at this point, but it is a joint document, and it's the instructions that came out in the early 1950s. And the instructions were that anything in the air that you couldn't identify that could conceivably be a threat to our national security would be reported. And now the reporting procedure, they said you had to create, I guess it was like a sit-rep. And what happened in this case, the radio officer came up onto the bridge, and he had a piece of paper in his hand, and he had the captain sign off on that piece of paper. And then he went back down to the radio shack where it was encrypted and then transmitted to who knows where.
Gotcha.
It goes off into the ether. Nobody tells us anything. We were not debriefed. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, the reason I'm speaking about it is that we were not debriefed. At least I wasn't. And it is an interesting story, but it doesn't end there. It actually goes a year down the road when I finally find out. And again, this is the synchronicity. If you kind of keep quiet and listen, you know, do more listening than talking. I'm doing a lot of talking right now. You're liable to find things that are of an important nature that may be overlooked otherwise.
Many people have known about the film Red October, which deals with a Russian sub that's a nuclear sub that's off the coast of the United States. We were speaking at lunch about some of the experiences you had that led you to believe that that story is actually really very close to an actual story that really happened.
Yes, and again, years later, documentary was put out. It was in the early 80s, I believe. But I didn't see it until much later. It originally came out on PBS. And basically what it was, it documented the raising of the K-129, which is a Gulf-class diesel-powered Russian submarine that was an early iteration of a ballistic missile sub. That submarine actually had three ballistic missiles that were located in the conning tower of the submarine. Mm-hmm. They were all nuclear. And it also had nuclear torpedoes, and that sub was on a very mysterious mission, apparently. And there were rumors, even back in those days, that the submarine had gone rogue, and that there was something that took place on the sub that caused it to sink in 16,000 feet of water. Now, again, it was years later that I realized exactly where that sub sank was on its way to Honolulu. And it was right within range of its missiles of being able to launch one of those missiles at Honolulu itself. And it was way off where its normal course would be, which would have taken it closer to the state of Washington and Oregon, which is where its normal duty station was. Years later, after the fall of the Soviet Union, after Glasnost and Perestroika, there was a lot of communications between the United States and the Russian government, and Boris Yeltsin actually released a lot of naval records. And when they were perusing these naval records, they actually found out a lot about that submarine, and the more they found out, the more questions that were raised. The submarine, this particular submarine, as all submarines are, it's a space for everything and everything in its space. The normal crew size for the mission was 85 crewmen. This sub, when it last left on its last mission, which was the questionable mission, actually left with, I think it was 95 men on board.
So that would be very cramped quarters.
Yeah, actually it was 98 men. And it was, it normally, even with the 85 or 86 man crew, it's cramped. There's not enough berths to go around, so the crew had a hot bunk.
Which means taking turns, sleeping, working or you're sleeping, you share your bunk
with
someone
else. Right, and you share the bunk.
So there wasn't really facilities to accommodate this increased crew.
No, and that includes food. I mean, if it was going on a normal mission, which I think would have been like 50 or 60 days, would have been on station, they would not have had enough food and probably other supplies as well. So the mission obviously was not what its normal mission would have been, which was a ballistic missile submarine. But the additional crew members, it turned out, were KGB. Now, the KGB at the time, I can't remember which he became one of the last premiers of the Soviet Union. He was the head of the KGB, and he was a very warlike, he was a real hawk. And at the time, in 1968, when the submarine was lost, the Russians and the Chinese were actually fighting. They were up on their border, and there was thought that they may even exchange nuclear weapons at some point.
It was a very tense time.
Very tense time.
Yes.
Anyway,
almost like the Cuban Missile Crisis, but few people really knew about it at the time.
Maybe. Exactly. The only thing, this one here, it had two communist allies that were getting ready to go toe-to-toe. Well, what happened was the belief, it was still a strong indication that the sub did go rogue, but they didn't know what the story was. With these additional crew members that were all KGB, the fact of the matter is that they had commandeered the submarine at gunpoint, and they held the Russian crew, and they had the Russian captain. They wanted to get the launch codes. There's a two sequence. In order to launch a ballistic missile, a nuclear ballistic missile, their doctrine called for, I believe, two different things. You needed one set of codes, then you needed another set of codes that would actually allow you to launch the missile.
Like a verifying system.
Yeah, yes. It's a verifying. It's a two-key approach, mm-hmm. if you will. Well, apparently what happened was, and there's a lot of people that are saying that that captain was a hero and that he actually averted World War III. Because it sounds like the plan, the one plan that I've seen, and again, it's conspiracy, was that the KGB wanted to launch one of those missiles at Honolulu and blame the Chinese in starting a war between the United States and China, and then Russia would step in and be the big dog on the block because nobody else would be left. But they think that the captain gave the wrong code, and when that wrong code was entered, it caused the warhead to blow up, causing a fire in the submarine, which sank the submarine. Now
the full circle to our interest in the UFO
yes.
topic.
Okay.
Begins with.
Okay. Well,
this
I was in 1970. I had come back from Vietnam, and I had one more Ocean Station Victor patrol to go out on, and it was during this period before we actually set sail, a large, interesting ship tied up in front of my ship in Honolulu Harbor, tied up to Sand Island, which is my Coast Guard base. And that ship turned out to be, it was made by Howard Hughes, and it was called the Glomar Explorer. Now, there's a synchronicity here that doesn't quite fit, and maybe I'm wrong, but I don't think so, because the only other ship it could have been was a ship called the Glomar Challenger. But the Glomar Challenger didn't have a flight deck, and it didn't have the name Glomar Explorer on the back. Now, this is in 1970. The Glomar Explorer was designed for one purpose and one purpose only, and that was to raise a sunken Russian submarine, and that was specifically the K-129. The cover story, though, in 1968, when they dreamt this up, was that that submarine, it was not going to be a submarine, that this was a special mining ship that would be mining magnesium nodules off the ocean bottom in 16,000 feet of water. Interestingly, that's the same depth that the K-129 went down in. So, so now what happened when that sub sank, the American Navy knew exactly where it went down, at least within 5 miles, because back in the 60s, they had seeded the Pacific and Atlantic Oceans and various other choke points with special listening devices that were very, very sensitive. And there were strings of these sonar-type devices that laid on the bottom of the ocean. And when the submarine went down, it reached a certain depth. And at that depth, it was crushed like a beer can.
Wow.
But the sound would travel for thousands of miles. And if you had a couple of these devices, all they had to do is measure the distance or the time that it took the sound to get there. And then they can triangulate to where the actual sub went down. Now, the Russians knew after a while that they had lost the sub, and they had no clue other than it was someplace in the Pacific Ocean. And everybody knows how big the Pacific Ocean is. Well, the US Navy knew within 5 miles. So from 1968 to the point where they were able to raise it, which was in 1974, they knew exactly where it was, and they designed a specific ship to do it. They also designed the lifting mechanism and the whole process. Howard Hughes built the ship,
Probably nobody else except Howard Hughes could have.
He was the only one that
been
could
in charge of certain technologies like that could have built something to actually raise the ship.
Especially,
and of course, it was very valuable to our Navy.
Exactly, you know. Exactly.
Now, I relate this to what we refer to as USOs, which stand for underwater unidentified flying objects. If I'm not correct, right?
Right.
Submersible or. What is it? USO stands for Unidentified Submersible
Objects. Right.
So how does that relate to this Russian sub story?
Well, it doesn't relate directly to that sub, at least that I've ever seen. However, the records that were released by the Russian Navy after Glasnost and Perestroika, they had a whole bunch of UFO-related sightings that were reported by Russian Navy ships. And one of the sightings was a Russian nuclear ballistic missile sub that was operating in the Pacific Ocean underwater. And all of a sudden, their sonar, which is very, very, was a pretty sophisticated device itself, picked up three USOs that were flying at it, coming at it underwater at a very, very high rate of speed. And the captain was sitting there watching this, and they changed depth and they changed direction. And the objects actually changed and were aiming straight for the ship, the submarine. The captain, I guess, panicked, and he ordered a full surface. Now, they were 800 feet deep when the objects were sighted. When I say sighted, mm-hmm. by their electronic devices, their sonar, everything. So they reported that, and that was reported to be a hostile action by the USOs. So. That and I say that I would believe that only because the 20 months that I was on board ship, we had three sightings. One was a USO related incident. Mm-hmm. Can't say exactly what it was, but
so it was an underwater event. Did it start in underwater and come up out of the water and take off?
Or? No, for me,
no. No, it was completely underwater.
Yeah, it was completely underwater. We were actually anchored off of a couple miles off the coast of Vietnam. And the captain gave permission for those who were not on duty, anchor watch, that they could have swim call. So they would be jumping overboard mm-hmm. into the Gulf of Thailand with all the orange and black poisonous sea snakes around. Yeah. And I was the quartermaster of the watch at the time, and I was up on the bridge, and we were just watching everybody having fun. And on the flying bridge, we had a gunner's mate up there with an M16. That was the shark guard. He was to protect the swimmers from sharks or whatever. Well, anyway, while we were up there, there were about six of us up on the bridge, and we're watching the men swimming. Looking back, it was the aft third of the ship. Now, my ship is 378 feet long, and it's about 40 feet wide, so it kind of gives you a good idea about scale of what you actually end up seeing. This particular object, and it was a teardrop-shaped black object, that swam under the aft third of the ship, directly underneath where the men were swimming. And we knew how deep it was because the ship was 17 feet deep, the keel of the ship.
Yes.
So it had to be below that in order to come from under the ship. And it was teardrop shaped. It was about 100 foot long, and it was about 30 to 40 foot wide. So it was not shaped like anything I would have expected. It was also, well, we immediately thought of whale sharks, whales, and we all figured that it seemed like it was too big to be a whale.
Nobody
at least
fired
a normal
on it,
whale.
Right? Nobody fired on it.
Nobody fired on it. No, it was too deep.
It was too deep.
It was just a real black object that was, you know, about 20 feet down. And we only saw it for about 7 or 8 seconds because the sky was overcast, so it was gray. And the wind, there was about a 5-knot wind. And the chop in the water helped obscure it after a while. If you were looking straight down, you saw it. But as it moved
yes.
out of the line of sight, it just disappeared
yeah, of course,
in the of conditions.
Course. Of course. You can only see it in certain ranges.
Right. But the thing was, what would have been the tail section or the fluke, it came to a point and there was none of this action
mm-hmm.
that was discernible.
Right.
So we then thought it was probably maybe a submarine. A miniature sub. We went into our
but
Bible.
But still, you don't have a sub that's that shape, right?
Well, we didn't know. So we went to our Bible, which was something that was called Jane's Ships of the World,
yes.
which was we
mm-hmm.
kept on the bridge and helped us identify all the warships mm-hmm. we would ever come across. Mm-hmm. And sure enough, there was absolutely no submarines that fit the size or the shape that we had seen.
Right.
Now, thinking back again, years later, there was a report of Megalodon being sighted down off of Cape Horn, South America, South Africa.
And what is Megalodon?
Megalodon is a prehistoric shark that supposedly died out years ago, but there have been sightings of it, and it's bigger than most whales.
I see.
And it's also a carnivore, and it is reportedly attacked large boats.
So interesting. So possibly it could have been something like that.
Yes.
Now, as I understand it, the Navy and the Coast Guard have to make these standard reports. What's your guesstimation of how many reports a year come in on average from the military?
I can tell you what I personally experienced on board ship. It was the three events. The last event was we had finished our deployment, our Westpac deployment, and we were heading back to Honolulu, and we were about a day and a half out of Guam, and we had just passed, as I remember it, we just passed the Marianas Trench, deepest part of the ocean.
Mm-hmm.
And that morning, I was shooting morning stars along with my chief, the officer of the deck, and the captain. The captain and the officer of the deck were actually operating the sextants. My chief and I were operating the stopwatches in order to get a good fix. We had to get a triangulation of three stars, and where they met when we plotted them would actually show us our location. Not quite as accurate as GPS.
So you're kind of using the stars, actually, to kind of tell you where you were, right?
Absolutely, yes.
Mm-hmm.
We use the sun and the stars for navigation every day, at least twice a day.
Mm-hmm.
Even though we had Loran, which is the early version of electronic navigation. Morning stars is shot a half hour before sunrise. Okay, there is no sun, it's below the horizon, but you have it's like daylight. Okay, so it was a beautiful day. It was like in June, as I remember. Yeah, it was in June, and it was a beautiful South Pacific day. You had a cloud cover, was maybe 10%. And the waves, there was maybe a 5-knot wind and a little bit of chop, but it was just a beautiful day. It's about 80 degrees. The temperature is already about 80. And we're out on the starboard bridge wing, which is the right bridge wing. And we were shooting forward. The captain and the OD were shooting stars that were in front of the ship where we were heading. All of a sudden, on a reciprocal course or the opposite course we were on, there was this large silver sphere. It wasn't silver, it was more like mercury, a perfect sphere of mercury. So just imagine what mercury looks like and the reflective qualities it had. That's exactly what this sphere had. The sphere was, and again, sometimes it's hard to judge sizes of objects because you don't know exactly what the distance is. So altitude and distance to the object, it may look like it's big and it may be very close, or maybe look like it's small and it's very far away. Well, this was probably about the size, when we first picked it up, it was about the size of, maybe twice the size of a pencil eraser. But again, those qualities, and it got closer and closer until pretty soon it was probably, I'm gonna estimate the size of that thing, was maybe 100 foot in diameter. Because it passed us on the port side of the ship, and it was up maybe no more than 500-600 feet.
Wow.
So, and it was on the exact opposite course, and it was not the wind blowing a balloon. The interesting thing about this object was that it perfectly reflected the sky and the clouds above, and it also perfectly reflected the waves and the color of the ocean below. It was a mirror. It was a spherical mirror, basically. Now, interestingly, in this part of the ocean, back during World War II, I believe it was the cruiser Indianapolis, the one that delivered the components for the atom bombs that were dropped on Hiroshima and Nagasaki, that was also the one that was sunk by a submarine after the surrender had been signed, and that's the one where many of the crew were eaten by sharks. It's a famous story.
Very famous story.
Anyway, there was a story about a sighting during World War II in that area, both from a cruiser, and I believe it was the Indianapolis, but also another object exactly like it. It was described as being rammed by some American fighters, and it fell and was sunk into the sea. So we can talk about the Pacific Ocean till the cows come home, because there have been sightings there from before the nuclear era, And during war, the Japanese were also seeing these as well. All described basically the same way. They were not disc-shaped. They were all spherical-shaped.
Fascinating. Very, very fascinating. From what I know of basic statistics, on average, just in the United States and Canada, there's about 13,000 sightings a year that are reported. And on average, 1 in 10 get reported. So you can extrapolate roughly, there's 100,000 sightings a year, and those are civilian-based sightings.
Yes.
They're not military-based sightings. I usually accept and recognize that military sightings are of a completely different nature, because these are trained observers, as mm-hmm. you were in the Coast Guard and other Navy people. When they're out there, they have to know all the different types of aircraft that exist, the speeds that they fly, the altitudes they fly, the weapon systems they carry, for all nations, in case they spot something that's Japanese or Russian, they can quickly identify it. And, you know, not only is radar used, but, of course, very sophisticated optics on deck, things like this.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
So I usually think that the military are a little more reliable when it comes to their own sightings. So I really gratefully appreciate you coming forward with your stories, and I very much encourage you to consider writing your experiences. Because as you said, in your field or your line with the Coast Guard, there were many times where you were not specifically debriefed. Now, many of the people that are the founders of MUFON and actively work with MUFON have come together because MUFON, of course, if you're just joining us, is the Mutual UFO Network. In MUFON, there is a commonality. It's kind of like a boys' club. A lot of ex-military people have come together. Many of them have had nuclear clearances, high-level clearances. They were moving, storing, or protecting nuclear weapons. Yes. When their experiences overlapped with USOs or UFOs, and their experiences are extraordinary. Now, many of them cannot legally speak about their experiences, even mm-hmm. till today, because of agreements they signed
yes.
protecting the safety of our country, which I completely respect and encourage them to continue to honor. But as we go forward, hopefully you will agree with me, at some point we need to open our perspectives and pay attention to the data and the evidence, because it leads us clearly to the understanding that there's something unusual going on, whether there's a very high-level breakaway society that Richard Dolan writes about. Maybe mm-hmm. we have a
yes.
black budget that's created technologies that are not foreign. They're produced maybe right here in the U.S. of A. or in other sophisticated
yes.
countries, but the operations go under the radar of the basic military and the basic public. Or there is, in fact, cooperation or integration going on with other species from other planets. We just don't know.
Exactly.
I'm Jennifer Stein, the host of the Mainline MUFON program. If you'd like to learn more about Mainline MUFON, you can visit Mainline MUFON, that's MUFON.com. MUFON stands for the Mutual UFO Network. It's an international organization which was founded over 30 years ago by a group of ex-military people who wanted to have a special place to come together and share their stories confidentially and to explore the UFO phenomenon for the betterment of humanity, specifically to present a scientific perspective wherever possible. I'm very proud to be a division of MUFON and very happy to run special programs at the Tredyffrin Public Library. So if you visit mainlinemufon.com, you can see the litany of programs that are there for the public free of charge. We hope some of you will decide to join us.